something new. Something different. Something entertaining. Something informative. Something creative. And something to listen to. You are listening to Something Cinematic. A show for moviegoers by a moviegoer.
Welcome to another edition of Something Cinematic on Blog Talk Radio. I am Timdiana, enduring it in search for credit, and once again I welcome you to the show. This week's review is the most talked about film to come out of this weekend, the fifth film in the X-Men franchise. None other than X-Men First Class. The film has received some great reception, even from the likes of Rotten Tomatoes. Yes, even Rotten Tomatoes has given it a good score. That may be so, but on this show, I shall be the judge and see just how good this film is. Is it worth your time, and does it do not just the franchise, but the comic book genre justice? Find out in this review of X-Men First Class. The story is about the X-Men before the X-Men are formed. and it takes place back in 1962. Yes, I remember looking that back in the history books. When the Cold War was starting, a conflict between the Russians and the U.S. started. And, of course, the reveal of the mutant kind. Yes, I remember that. I didn't pass that test. But anyway, this, as I said, this is the story before the X-Men are even formed. With the first meeting of Charles Xavier and Eric Lenchen, who becomes Magneto. Spoiler alert! That may be so, but you know what? As I said in the in last week's show, I thought that was a really interesting idea to see the beginning of Charles Xavier and Magneto and see how that turned out on film. And I have to say, it makes for one heck of a story. The movie had some terrific pacing, and it really had a great three-act structure. I mean, I would really tell there was like a significant difference between Act 1, Act 2, and Act 3. And it's like, it felt like each act was like its own story. And so it's just surprising because it still follows, you know, the major story of the film. But for some reason, they could stand on their own. It was impressive. It's a marvelous three-act structure. In fact, I had to say it's a very perfect three-act structure. And with all these elements of the story, it makes for some terrific storytelling. It really. And as I said, it's very original. As I said, with the idea of having, you know, the story between Xavier and Magneto for starting off and forming, you know, and the creation of the X-Men. It was just a very original idea to see. And it didn't work out like, you know, most superhero films do. I mean, yeah, you see like the superheroes form and that stuff. You do see that, but still, it felt very different from the rest of the superhero movies. And I had to give it props for that. As I said, that is just some wonderful, wonderful storytelling. Now, when it came to characters of X-Men First Class, I know what I have to say. It's actually a very strong cast. Very surprising to see how well-formed this cast was. And I know some may complain about the continuity of the characters. For example, people will say, well, you know, Mystique wasn't part of the X-Men. And Havoc wasn't back in 1962. He's Cyclops' brother. What's he doing in 1962? What's he doing there? Well, that may be so. You know, on paper, it looks really weird. But the turnout was absolutely perfect. I mean, for the characters they decided to go with in this movie, it really worked. It worked, and it's very surprising to see that, you know, we could take these characters out of the universe that we know, that the comic book fans know them from, and somehow form them into this film, and yet, for some reason, it's understandable, and it works. Another thing that was really great to see is the villains of this film, which was the Hellfire Club. And really, when you look at it, they were just a prelude to the Brotherhood. But you know what? I think that was a good decision to go with. It was a good idea because, you know, as I said, it is the prelude to the Brotherhood. So we get that idea where the Brotherhood came from. And basically, we do see how it's formed. But yeah, I think that was just a good idea to go with because it has that idea where Magneto got the idea from the Brotherhood. Speaking of which, the film had some tremendous, and terrific, and just plain out good character development. And the one who particularly stood out to me, who I'm going to start this all off with, is Magneto. What a great way to develop this character. Now, maybe it was because, you know, we've seen him in three other films that really helped this character. But I think seeing the backstory of him, seeing how he first started off, brought this character to full circle. He had some really great scenes, some really great character development. There were times, you know, when you saw him throughout this movie with his scenes with Xavier and seeing some good in Magneto, you felt like there was a possibility that this character could be, you know, he could turn out good in the end. You know, he could find a way to make peace with himself. But at the same time, you knew that wasn't going to happen because he had to become Magneto. So that was really some great character development. And I was really, really impressed with the character of Magneto. Now, that's not to say that I wasn't also impressed with the likes of Charles Xavier, because he too has a great development. It was great to see that character, where he came from and what he becomes. Because at the very beginning of the film, he's not, you know, he's not the wise character that we know him to be. He's not, for one thing, he's not Patrick Stewart. He's not the man in the wheelchair yet. And, you know, we saw that he was a student at, I can't remember what school, I think it was Oxford. If I'm wrong, you can completely tail me off and like, no, you're wrong, that's not where he was from. But yes, he was a college student, he became a professor, but you also saw that he liked the party, and he was, as I might say, he was very good with, very charming to the girls. Because he knew he was going to become Patrick Stewart. That's what they knew. Yes. But anyway, but you know, he was very energetic, he wanted to have a good time. And then we see him turn into the, you know, the man that we know him to be, the leader that he had to be, becoming the teacher to the, this new age of beings, the being with the teaching these new mutants their powers and how to use their powers. And it's just, it was really great to see that. So it's just like Magneto, it's great to see that full circle for the character of Charles Xavier. Another one I particularly like, I like the character development, I like this relationship between Mystique and Beast. Because, you know, there was a romance story that was kind of at first advertised, and there was plainly something there throughout the movie. But they, you know, they do have their differences by the end of the film. And, you know, the problem that they have is that these two characters feel like they're too different. They don't want to be like the different. They don't want to be look different. They want to have, you know, they just don't, they want to fit in. And that's where they go through most of the film. And as the movie progresses, we see that, you know, they kind of split, because Mystique becomes like, she doesn't need to feel like she has to hide anymore. Well, Beast still wants to, but, you know, in inevitability, it doesn't really turn out well for Beast. But, you know, that was kind of, it shows that kind of character we see in X-Men, particularly with Rogue. Like that character we've seen in the past, in the first three movies, and not just that, but also the comics. We see that, you know, how she wants to fit in, how she wants to be like the others, but she can't. Well, we get to see that kind of character in both Beast and Mystique. And I like that. I like that because it really worked. It was really cool to see for a subplot, and it was really great to see those characters form. The movie has some terrific performances. I like the chemistry between James McAvoy and Michael Fassbender, who has, you know, Charles Xavier and Magneto. Really, they had some great performances, and, you know, it really also brings that, it's great to see how, compare that with Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen. I'm not saying like they're the same, I don't want to take away from either of those groups' performances, but, you know, I feel like, you know, in a weird way, the performances connect. I'm not sure what they did to plan that out, but I think it worked. I think it was very comfortable, and I think it just works well together, and I don't think it takes anything away from either performance. But you know the one performance that I was really, really, really surprised with? Kevin Bacon as the villain Sebastian Shaw. I was not expecting this from Kevin Bacon. I mean, he's Kevin Bacon. You know, Footloose. Freaking Footloose. How does it go from Footloose to being the notorious Sebastian Shaw? I mean, I didn't even know how he would do a role like this, because I don't think I've ever seen him in a role like this, and Hollow Man does not count. I don't think Kevin Bacon wants to remember that. But anyway, how would he do this? And I saw him as Sebastian Shaw, and he was evil, for one thing, and he was believable in his evil. And it's like, wow, this is Kevin Bacon. Where did this come from? What have you been doing these past years? Damn it. Anyway, moving right along, though, but as I said, this was a very surprisingly well-formed cast and had some terrific performances. Really surprising when it comes to this particular factor in X-Men First Class.